From the west. In fact, this morning he does not remember the forever his king.
Come on, declare,
our God reigns.
For
Come on, he's not in the storm, he's not in the rain, for he speaks in a still small voice. He speaks this morning. Thank you. your spirit this morning.
Thank you. Bible says everything is naked and open unto the eyes of whom we have to deal with. Hallelujah. And let the Holy Ghost flow through here and take a look. Find a heart to land on. Hallelujah. His eyes are open, running, looking for that heart. Hallelujah. He's ready to receive. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Hey, somebody want to know what was all that noise? Somebody want to know what was all that noise? Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Hey. Some unbelievers want to know what was all that was. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Surely, surely, we have been. Surely, surely. Presence of the Lord. strength of being today. Hallelujah. Give your life for me. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What am I to you? Hallelujah. That you love me. Glory, you took all of his stuff with you. Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Took all of his strength when you crossed over. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Well, hallelujah. I want you to look into your resources. Hallelujah. Glory in the name of the Lord. Look into your resources. Determine what you can bring to the house of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Hey. You may want to look and see what has the Lord blessed me with. Hey. What did the Lord bring to me? Hallelujah. What have I gotten if it wasn't for the Lord? Hallelujah. You may want to think, what would I be if it wasn't for him? Hallelujah. Glory to God.
been lifted this morning. Amen. I tell you, if you missed it, you missed it. I really don't feel like giving these announcements because the spirit is still wrong. Now, some of you I know got yours. You heard you. And then there was a session that was real quiet. Maybe you were just being reflected. You know, sometimes some people are just reflecting. Thank you, Lord. But we certainly hope that the Spirit of the Lord was in the house, that
Amen.
He visited you, and that you were receptive. And Brother Williams often says, let the Father God hear words from your mouth, let him hear your praises. And it's nothing like you uttering those praises out of your mouth to him. Yeah, because there is a liberation when you do that. It's a liberation. There is a raise in praise. You hear me? There is a raise in praise. Hallelujah. And you know, when you begin to reflect and think about God's goodness and what he is to you, hallelujah. I don't know how you can't keep from praising the Lord. Yes, amen. I was thinking, sitting there reflecting on a scripture in Psalms that says, oh God, thou art my God, early will I seek thee. Yes, to see, hallelujah. And it goes on to say, my soul longeth for thee, and my spirit thirsts for thee in a dry and thirsty land. And I think it's been dry and thirsty somewhere around here.
Yes.
To see him in the sanctuary, just to see him as he's seen him. That's what the psalmist said, as I've seen you in the sanctuary. Because thy loving kindness, why, is better than life. Hallelujah. I will praise thee. And I will lift my hands in the sanctuary. I will lift my hands in the sanctuary. Hallelujah. My soul. You see, he's talking about your soul. It's your soul. Praise your soul. Is it well with you? Goes on to say, my soul shall be satisfied. As church, and he said, do we need to just stop praying? You know, I think he was discouraged with the way people had responded in prayer. And it was Brother Rod says, oh no, we don't need to. Sister Shirley said, oh no, Pastor, we don't need to stop praying. It was prayer that has brought us this far. And it's prayer that's going to continue to take us. Don't you see the results of it? Now, some of you were here in prayer Monday night. Some were here in prayer Wednesday night. Some were in prayer this morning. Amen. And I know you prayed at home. I know you prayed at home. But there is a time for corporate prayer. The prayers of the righteous availeth much. Amen. Amen. So we're going to continue in prayer. We want you to continue in prayer. It's no time to stop now. It's not any time to give up now. How many of you know that I'm reminded of a story that Pastor told me, I can take this time. The man that were prospecting for gold. Everybody was going out west. There had been a call. Oh, there's gold out here. There's riches out here. They were going out. And there was this man that was digging and digging and digging. And everybody else was finding things. And he wasn't finding anything. He says, apparently, they have misrepresented something. There's no gold. There is no gold. I'm tired of digging. I'm just tired of digging. And he threw his shovel down. And do you not know that the very next day, not the next week, not the next month, but the next day, someone came and began to dig in the same hole that he'd been digging, and they struck gold. He gave up one day too soon. Just one day too soon. Where are you? Are you tired of digging? Are you tired of digging? Are you tired of praying? Are you tired of coming to church? Are you tired? Are you tired of reading? Are you tired of studying? Are you tired of submitting your life to the Lord? Don't give up that day too soon. Hold on. You keep your shovel. Whatever you need, you keep it. Don't give up. There are often times we just get tired and want to throw in the towel and say, it's not worth it. But let me say to you, it's worth it. Hold on. Don't you give up. If you're doing good, continue to do good. If you've been slack, let's take up the slack and get with the program. And I mean God's program. Glory to God. I didn't mean to say all of that. Glory to God. I'm going to cut off now. And time is far spent. But I just want to encourage you, because I know there are many in the body here. We all have certain needs. And what I may be dealing with, you may not be dealing with. Some of you know I wasn't here last Sunday, and I hadn't planned to tell this. But I got up to get ready, and my arm, this arm, praise God. It was like, what is wrong with my arm? It was like somebody took a knife and was stabbing me in the arm. That's how it felt. It was periodically, and I just couldn't get dressed. And, I found out this week that I have rotator cuff tear. But you know what? That's not going to stop me. It's painful, but it's not going to stop me. I'm going to still praise the Lord. You don't have that. You may not be dealing with that, but you have something else that you're dealing with. But should that stop you from praising the Lord? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. We know that the devil, the enemy, comes to bring, to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But I know that Jesus Christ came to bring life. And that's what I'm looking for. That life that he brings, not what the enemy brings. Now, he's going to bring something to all of our doorsteps. Just like when you have a special delivery, sometimes you have to sign for those things. But when the enemy brings you something, and you open the door and see that it's the enemy, you don't have to sign for it. You can slam the door. It's okay to this morning. Whatever it is that you're dealing with, it may be an illness that you have. It could be a failed marriage. It could be a job that you're looking for. You've been looking and you've been turned down 100 times. Go back. Keep looking. Keep digging. Keep digging. Don't give anybody else your shelter. Hold on to it. Even when the devil comes to get it, you say, no, it's mine.
Yes.
This was won on the cross, the blood of Jesus.
Amen. And he was praying.
believe that God is doing something supernatural. I've been praying that God will really stir up some of these brothers. Amen. Put that broken spirit on them. Yes. Amen. I believe, Brother Rodney, I believe it's happening for you, brother.
Yes.
Amen. The Lord told me that Jesus is the answer.
Yes, it is.
It's the answer. Amen. All that you're trying to figure out and work out, Jesus is the answer. When I say Jesus is the answer, that means surrendering and yielding to Him. Like you were doing this morning, that is the answer. So you guys, you can do that, right? It'll take more money to do that. Hallelujah! Come on, lift your hands and say hallelujah. Oh, bless your name. Bless your name. Sister Hope, I don't know what happened to you this morning. You don't normally act that way on Sunday morning. You do better on Monday night. He's making her complete. She's learning how to yield. She's learning how to give it all over to God. Amen. God has worked miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. From a natural perspective, she shouldn't be here today. From a natural perspective. Amen. But from a spiritual, Scripture says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus makes us free. Sin and death. Oh, the law of faith is still working. How many can say amen?
Amen.
It is a genuine, tangible, powerful than the law of sin and death. Oh, God, we just thank God for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. He can make you free. Lift your hands and say, Jesus can make me free. Jesus can set me free. I don't know what specifically God was working out, but if you have an idea what it is, you can get up and say it. If you don't know, you will know. Hey, you will know. Amen. Brother Rob, some great things are going to begin to happen in your life.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. The Lord began to show me that. Amen. All of the prayers, you know, Sister Hill was teaching of that. Amen. Friday, Wednesday night, I said, we might as well, you know, have three or four people here. I said, we might as well just stop praying. Nobody's responding, you know, and it's not doing no good. That's how we surmise from a natural perspective. Amen. And so I just threw it out. I was just challenging. I didn't expect them to say, oh, yes, that's all stop. I didn't expect them to say that. But I was just throwing out the hook just to see how people are going to respond. Because if everybody feels like we need to stop praying, we probably do need to stop. Amen. But even if everybody stops, amen. Sometimes no matter how they show up, boy, you just so. I said, does anybody want to make things go? Does anybody feel the need? Sometimes you feel that way. Amen. Y'all got to say amen. I don't think it's fair just two or three or four people have to keep everything going. Amen. Otherwise, amen. But that's the way it is. So I came to a point. I just said, well, Lord, amen. I'll just kind of leave it in your hands. Brother Rob was one of those that stepped up and played Pastor Hill. Amen. I remember a few years ago I came to this church and my life has been turned completely around and this and that and the other. And he said, the Lord is still working on me and he ain't through with me yet. And boy, this morning, the Lord showed out. Amen. Brother Rock was down here. Amen. Just pulling out his heart. Amen. I think whatever God needs to fix, I believe that God is doing it in his life. Amen. I'm just so happy for that. Amen. So we just want to say, we're going to be going shortly. But we want to admonish all of you. I know that your schedules are so different, and some of y'all work, y'all try so hard to work prayer time into your schedule, Bible study into your schedule. It's very, very difficult. So I'm just suggesting this. There will be times I feel that we really need to just pull back and just let the Lord do what he needs to do like he did this morning. What you said, Brother Dave, you have a word from God. You got something you want to say? Because you started it all this morning. You got a word? You got something? Amen. All right, come on, Brother Dave. Just whatever the Lord showed you or whatever you see, you can relate that. We're going to be gone today at 12:30. Amen. So here's Brother Dean. Amen. Well, Pastor, last night I was with my kids at the Mabee Center, and sometimes when we go through difficult times, when we have trials, we can tend to get our focus off of what God originally told us. And Pastor, last night there were probably 10,000 young people in this auditorium, and I've been to some of the meetings where they sing three or four songs, and but the Holy Spirit just began to move in that place, and mostly teenagers, you know, under 18. And it was in that atmosphere that God began to speak to me about. I've had some very difficult things happen personally in my life the last probably 5 years. And he began to stir back in me. It's so easy to forget what God told you. It's so easy to, you know, those of you that are married understand what I'm talking about. You know, the Bible says that when we're married, it's a picture of Christ loving the church. It is that fresh love. You know, Jesus doesn't ever get old. You know, his love never gets old. But how many know that sometimes in relationships, we enter into relationships and the relationship gets stagnant? Life happens. Mark talks about it. The word is choked by the cares of life. And last night I was in a repentant mode. And that simply means to change your mind. And my heart this morning was I really began to see in this church. I mean, there's several people. Sometimes the Lord will give me release to share specifically with people. There are people in this room. God's spoken some things to you that you know that you know that you know was Him. I mean, I know there's some folks in the room. And cares of life come to choke the word. The trials of life. You know, those that are righteous in Christ will suffer persecution. It's part of living in this earth. But the Lord, last night and this morning as we were worshiping this morning, the Lord just, it was a picture for me of perseverance, not in worship, just in worship, but in our lives to contend for the faith. And this is what I tell my kids, you know. I used to work at the Dream Center, and we used to work with teenagers my whole life. And young people, you know, many times they'll pray a prayer, they'll go through the motion, and they'll go about their business. It's not in the mouthing and the parenting of the words, if you know what I'm saying. And in marriage, it's not the piece of paper that says so-and-so is married to so-and-so. It is the passion and the life. Does anybody understand what I'm saying? It's the love. It's the intangible things. The love, the fire, the passion that brings life to a relationship. And I just this morning, I felt that many in this room, there is a persevering. See, many times when we contend individually, we don't realize that many other people, the scripture says, are dealing with the same exact thing. And that you're not alone this morning. And this is what I saw last night. I'll just give you a picture of this. As these 10,000 young people began to persevere. They just began to persevere in worship. We live in a culture where many of you, any of you that have teenagers, any of you that work with anybody under 18, understand the culture has gone absolutely insane. Right is wrong and wrong is right. Absolutely insane. And I saw in that room, the kids began to come up after worship for about an hour and a half. You know, the legs that were healed and kids that had been suicidal and kids that had been cutting themselves, different things that were coming out. And the word of the Lord that I felt this morning was this church has been contending. Pastor, you all have been contending for the faith. You have been contending for what God originally spoke to you. And there is victory in the word when you begin to declare and when you begin. And I'm telling you, this is what I felt in my heart this morning. You've been carrying it. And I'm going to be very careful about what I'm saying and how I'm saying it. Pastor, you as a leader, as a fivefold ministry gift, have been carrying. But there is now, this is a season now. And I saw as my brother was up here, it was a picture as some of you began to enter into worship for yourself, as you began to contend as the Spirit, not based on a feeling, not based on anything, but knowing Jesus is Lord, I'm going to open my mouth. I'm going to open my mouth. I used to run the mile, and it's four laps around, and there were times I had no oxygen left, and it was just put one foot in front of the other. That's all I could do is keep going. And for many of us in this room, the example that is laid before, now it's time for you to pick the baton up. And I speak this specifically. There are specific people in this room that have ministry gifts, fivefold ministry gifts, Pastor. An anointing, a calling. And the cares of life and things that are going, even now your mind is wandering, even now. This is what's happened to me. I mean, it's hard. It's not easy. Even Jesus, when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, sweat, blood, he said, would you take this cup from me? But there was a point of surrender. There was a point of surrender. When I knew that, I looked at my wife and I said, she's the one. I just go down on my knees. And that is a picture of bowing the knee. This morning, there are many of you. I feel this so strong in my heart. It's easy to mouth the words. It's easy to have the piece of paper. It's easy to it's not easy to show up. Sometimes it's not easy even just to show up. Sometimes showing up is half the battle. But God wants to begin to engage your heart. God wants to engage your heart. And what does that mean this morning? But the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. I mean, the Bible says that in the last days, because of the increase of evil, many's hearts will grow cold. Because of all the buffeting of what we see on TV and all the different things, and the things that you're going through in your family, the things you're trying to do with finances, the things you're going through with your kids, and because of the buffeting, the hearts of men will grow cold. And this morning, Pastor, what I felt to share, God says, I want to restore to you the joy and the love and the passion of your salvation. And let me tell you something, it does not happen. It does not happen by us striving. It happens by us waiting on Him. You know, when my wife and I go through times of where we're just missing each other, we're talking but we're not hearing each other, time to get away and time to reconnect. And I believe this is a season where many of you, God's called you to pick the, and this is not maybe a shouting, but I'm telling you, this is a specific word for, there's at least four or five of you in the room, and every believer that's in here, that it's time to pick the baton up. You've been buffeted, things have come against you, in your health, finances, relationships. There's a couple men in this room, I know by the Spirit of God, that there has been a demonic onslaught against you, to literally sift you like wheat. And Jesus said to Peter in the same way, I prayed for you that your faith would fail not. And the point is, we can go through the motions, we can go through the thing, and our heart is not engaged. And we go into robotic mode. And God wants to pour into you the oil and the wine. He wants to pour into you the joy of your salvation. If we could, Pastor, just this morning, just for a moment, if you just close your eyes and lift your hands to Him. You know, seeing 10,000 young people worshiping unashamed, I mean jumping, screaming, running, white, black, Hispanic, Native American, there is a revival coming to this earth like no one has ever seen. I read it this morning in Joel chapter 2. The latter rain will be greater than the former. The things that we will see for those, I'm not talking about in our own strength. What Pastor's talking about is bowing the knee. Simple prayer. We've lost prayer. And it may start for you personally at home with 5 minutes. Yeah, some of us have been so busy we can't even spend 5 minutes. That's the truth. This is the spirit of the age. And God is saying, brother, sister, I'm calling you to carry the mantle in this church. Why? Because I see these seats full of those that are coming to be rescued by Christ. And you're going to be the one. You're going to be the one. Just say, I'm going to be the one that will carry the baton. If that's you, I just simply by an act, just simply stand. I will be the one. I will carry the baton as Christ gives it. And I don't want you to do it flippantly. As the Lord gives you, just simply stand and say, I will. I will carry the baton for you, Christ. I will get out of being a robot, and I will allow you to engage my heart. For his yoke is easy and his burden is light. For you have been striving in your own strength. And God says this morning, I want you to take my yoke on you. Yes, you've missed some doors because you weren't praying. Yes, you've missed some opportunities. But he said in Joel, I will restore the years that the cankerworm has stolen, that the palmerworm, where it seems like life has eaten away at the fatness and the pleasure of your life. And God says, my sister, he's restoring. There's a mantle of leadership upon your life, and a strength and a gifting. The Spirit of the Lord says, I want you to begin to cast down fear and to begin to step into the fullness of what I've called you to be and to do in the earth realm. For you are my daughter of Zion, said the Spirit of God. Oh, and I am pouring joy back into your life. For the grief of the past, the grief of loss, the grief of what was taken from you, God says, I'm going to restore to you. Open your heart, open your life, and receive, said the Holy Spirit of God. And as your mouth begins to say, Lord, I receive. As your mouth and your posture of your life begins to open up. For there is a posture. David prostrated himself. Daniel prostrated himself. There is a posture. And God says, I'm going to pour into you the oil and the wine. The oil representing healing. The wine representing the power of the Holy Ghost. A new and a freshness and a joy comes upon you, said the Spirit of God. My brother, I tell you, it's been hard. The reason why it's been hard, there's always a test before the testimony. But let me tell you what I see on the inside of you. I see a boldness. I see a willingness. See, when you're in the world, you're willing to do whatever to whoever for whatever reason. You lived loud for the devil. And see, sometimes as men, we come into the church and we think we need to lay all of our masculinity down. This is a word for you, my brother. Lay down all of our aggressiveness, our assertiveness. Because when we were in the world, we were going after it. The Spirit of the Lord wants to do something in your mind this morning to begin to see. He said, look to the hills from whence comes your help. Your help comes from the Lord. To begin to look to the hills and see Jesus. He's not called you to lay your sword down. He's not called you to lay down your weapons. The weapons of your warfare are not carnal now. They are mighty through God. And your mouth, see, you did a lot of damage with your mouth for the devil. And now God says, I'm going to use your mouth as an instrument in your house, as an instrument to speak blessing instead of curse, to speak life. And in the next, I prophesy to you, in the next 5 to 6 days, you're going to begin to see people, and your mouth is going to begin to speak the words of salvation. You're going to catch yourself, because the Spirit of God is in you. I don't say you're an evangelist, but the spirit of the evangelist, the spirit of one that's called to proclaim good news, is on the inside of you. And that's why the enemies attack you, and the Spirit of the Lord will say to you, son, I've raised you up for such a time as this. Your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth will be used in the kingdom of God. And as you speak, the spirit of faith says, I believe, therefore I speak. Don't ever let the devil shut you up. When you believe, when faith comes in, you begin to speak it. If you read it and faith comes, speak it. See, he's trying to put a muffle on you. And God says, I release you to speak the word of the Lord. In the name of Jesus. In the name of the Lord. In the name of Jesus. Sister, you were standing and I felt so strong for you. This is a season for you of new beginnings. This is a season for you of freshness. For even as the seasons pass and the leaves fall and new grass is uprooting, even as we speak, and greenery is coming forth. I hear Psalm chapter 1 that says, this is like a man whose life is planted by the streams of water, whose leaf does not wither. For people have looked at you and wondered, why have you not withered? Because you have been planted by the stream. And this is a season. It further says, who will bring forth fruit in due season. And I tell you, sister, this is a season of fruitfulness for you. Yes. Fruit. And what is he saying specifically for you? He's saying this is a time of fruitfulness in relationships. For when the devil tries to attack you, he brings a relationship. When God blesses you, he brings a relationship. And God is presenting some relationships. Church relationships, business work relationships, family friend relationships. And God's calling you now to disconnect from some other and to connect with those that you know have been brought into your life for such a time as this. God, we thank you now. We praise you now. I have to say this, brother. This is very, very pivotal, your positioning. Very pivotal, your positioning. Can I, Pastor, is it okay if I believe that his positioning in the church is very pivotal for the health of the church. God gives gifts. He gives fivefold ministry gifts so that all come into the faith, to the oneness of the faith. And your ministry gift, my brother, is going to help some that have not been able to come up to that level. And God is positioning you, and there's some things on your heart that you've held back on that you're to share with pastor and leadership that need to happen. Because there are some that won't get it all in the service. They'll get it one-on-one. They'll get it sitting and having coffee at Starbucks. They'll get it in conversations in a work environment. And it's almost like I see you're releasing the oaks of righteousness in this place. I mean, there is an anointing upon you to release leaders, to multiply leaders, Pastor. I see leaders coming out of his bosom. Where you have carried, I see leaders coming forth. Leaders that will carry the wheat, the way leaders that can. And this, one other thing, this women's ministry, that there are men and there are women being raised up. There are men and there are women being raised up. There are men and there are women being raised up. Why? Because they're coming. See, they're coming, they're coming. They're coming through the doors. I see them coming. And if, there will be no time for you to stand back and say, I wonder if I should. They're going to come. They're coming. I'm saying this prophetically. They're coming. They're coming. They're coming. And are you ready? I hear what's going to happen on Tuesday. For when, this isn't just for you ladies. This is for those that are coming. So you have something to give to them. Brothers, this isn't just for you to have a good fellowship time. This is for you to sharpen each other because they're coming. And some of you are going to go out and grab them. For this has to do with life and death. But the cares of life, many of you can cause you to lose sight. And today, in the name of Jesus, Father, we release, we release, we release, we release your grace and your anointing. We release your power. We release the unction from the Holy Ghost. Just for a couple minutes, just pray in the Spirit. Just for a couple minutes. This is, it's for you. This is where the joy comes, when you're released in the church. He said, we are fitly joined together. Every joint supplying a need. You're a joint. You're supplying a need. And when you don't show up, the joint is not going to work. Just like Sister Marilyn said, her shoulder was hurting because the thing tore. And you're a joint in this church. No longer are you to say, I'm not important. I'm saying this corporately. No longer are you to say, it doesn't matter if I don't show up. For when you show up, you bring a grace that is only upon your life. Come on, just lift your hands. Just for us. I'm just saying 2 or 3 minutes. That's it. And we're going to be done. And just begin to call. See, he's stirring and fanning into flame the gift of God that is in you. And I've said it before, Pastor. I see many races coming through the door. Many ethnicities coming through the door. For what God is going to do is going to be what we see in heaven in Revelation 7:9 in this church. Every nation, tribe, and tongue coming. Prepare yourself. Prepare yourself. And Lord, I pray a release of grace and anointing and wisdom and understanding. Even those that are young couples and feel like they're just surviving, I release an anointing to understand that you're not just surviving. You're a part of this ministry and this church, and you have something to give. And even though it may just be showing up, and maybe it may just start praying 5 minutes in the morning, what you bring to the table is important to the Spirit of the living God. For they're coming, and it may be just you that will have a word in season. Last but not least, there is coming a compassion. I felt it during worship. There is coming a compassion where literally you'll weep for those that don't know Jesus. The Bible says that Jesus looked across Israel and he began to weep because they were like, the wording of the scripture says, like chickens without a mother hen, like scattered, fatherless, motherless, abused and neglected. And God says, I'm going to put within this church, I feel it so strong, Pastor, a heart and a compassion that will literally weep for those when they walk through the door, the compassion of God. Because they've gone on the street, they've gone another place and been judged and talked about, but they're going to come in this house and there's going to be love and compassion meeting them at the door. Will that be you? Will that be you? Will that be you? So Father, this morning, God, just as everybody stands and Pastor comes, God, thank you. Thank you that when you move by your Spirit, it's not just for us. You move by your Spirit because you're doing something in us to will and to do your good pleasure. And God, I thank you for that work that you're doing in us. Come on, just thank him. One more minute.
Just pray in the Spirit. One more minute. I thank you for what you're doing in me. This is an hour and this is a season where you better be more clued in to what the Spirit of God is saying than CNN or BET. It's a time for you to hear. I'm not against TV. I'm just saying you need to be tied in to what God is saying to you. What season it is for you. And not to look to the right or the left, but to know God has his finger and his hand upon your life. Get the picture again of you taking the baton and running with it. For eye has not seen nor ear heard the wonderful things he has in store for those that love him, except he reveal it by his Spirit. And this morning he's revealing, I see it like gears going into place, just clicking. He's revealing by his Spirit. Wives and husbands, mothers and fathers, he's revealing what you're to do, and you're going to begin to pick up the baton. And pastor, in the next couple weeks, it's not going to be a labor, but they're going to begin to call you and come up. Where you've had to call them, they're going to begin to call you, pastor. I say this so humbly because I normally don't like to give a word to a whole church, but they're going to begin to come to you. And they're not just going to come saying, what should I do? This is how you're going to know. They're going to come saying, this is what the Lord showed me I'm supposed to do. Now help me have direction in this. And there's going to be a release of two or three major ministries, outreach oriented, out of this church in the coming days. And they're going to come. As the men and the women find their place of leadership. Jesus.
Yes. Yes. Brother John Dorsey's family, I understand to hear. I just want you to come down. I just want to have a word of prayer. I understand that there's a real critical need existing in the family. So if you'd like to come down, we'd just like to agree with you on, I believe it's the Dorsey's family, just we acknowledge their presence this morning. They are here and understand they have us. Gravely ill loved one in Oklahoma City. This is the reason why all of them have come together. But we just do believe that